Hello everyone. In today's class, we'll be learning about thyroid hormones, its actions and function tests. As per the CBME curriculum, today we are dealing with two competencies. The first competency under 8.2, our first objective is by the end of this class, the student should be able to describe the physiological actions of the thyroid hormones. And the second objective under competency 8.4, describe the thyroid function tests. So we have only two objectives for today's class. Let's begin with the physiological actions of the thyroid hormones. So one thing very special about the thyroid hormone is virtually every single cell, every single system is affected by these thyroid hormones. Probably there are no cells which is not affected by the thyroid hormones. So hence, its functions are very diverse and numerous functions are there. So let's begin with the first one, its action on growth and development. So if you recall, we learned about growth hormone, which was having a very great role in the growth and development. So second only important for growth is this thyroid hormones. So growth means physical growth. And when we use the word development or maturation, it is more about the functional aspects. Okay, so growth is the physical growth and development or maturation is about the improvement in the functionality. So for both the things, thyroid hormones are essential. So thyroid hormones are essential for physical growth, that is musculoskeletal and visceral, and mental growth and maturation. So since it is playing such an important role in both growth and development and maturation of the body, a deficiency causes stunting in mental as well as physical growth. We will see about all these in detail when we go to the applied aspects. Okay? So the first one is the action on growth and development. The next action on CNS. It has a marked effect on brain development, even beginning from in utero. That is when the baby is in utero, the action of the thyroid hormones are very essential. Even a pregnant lady, the normal thyroid hormones to be in the normal level is very essential. Otherwise, in utero itself, the fetus will be affected. So, what are the action on the CNS? It acts on the synapses required for myelination, cerebral cortex, and the basal ganglia. So in all this, so areas, the thyroid hormones are essential. Also, one more important thing is this thyroid hormones activates the RAS. RAS means reticular activating system. So reticular activating system, when it is active, it makes the person active. When this is not activated, the person goes into sleep. Inactivation of it causes sleep. So whenever thyroid hormones are there, it will promote the activity and the awake state. If it is not there, then if there is a deficiency, the person will feel sleepy. So hence, the deficiency, we have seen that in the CNS, it is having a widespread effect on the brain, acting starting from the in utero. So a deficiency results in mental retardation, motor rigidity, and the responses to reflexes are prolonged. So reflexes, as you know, there are superficial and deep reflexes. When we try to elicit these reflexes, the response will not be quick or brisk. It will be more delayed, prolonged. Okay, so this is the action on CNS. Coming to the next action on cardiovascular system. So to remember that it is both ionotropic and chronotropic would be make the thing simpler to know the action. So basically, it increases the heart rate cardiovascular system acting. The important or peculiar aspect of this is this not only increases heart rate in an awake state, but we can know that if there is an excess of thyroid hormones, sleeping pulse rate, if any time, if it is due to anxiety or sympathetic overdrive, something, heart rate may be increased. After exercise, it may be increased. But if the sleeping pulse rate is increased, we can be sure that it is because of almost 100% that it is because of the thyroid, excess of thyroid hormones. Okay, this is because of the increased sympathetic activity that is being activated by the thyroid hormones. In addition, the thyroid hormones also increase the stroke volume, cardiac output, and blood pressure. So it is having a positive effect, increasing all the functions of the heart. Heart rate, stroke volume, cardiac output, and the blood pressure. Coming to the action on GIT. On the gastrointestinal tract, it promotes normal intestinal motility, tone, and increases the digestive secretions. So, the normal thyroid hormone levels are important for all this to remain normal. If there is excess of thyroid hormones, okay, we can see that there will be increase in the gastric emptying, increase in the intestinal motility, so much so that there may be diarrhea. Okay, so that is in the excess thyroid hormones. So the normal action is to maintain. When they are in normal proportion or normal levels, they're not going to cause either excess or reduced actions. They will promote normal motility, normal tone, normal digestive secretion. Okay. Only when they are in excess, they are going to increase the motility and hence may result in diarrhea. So when a deficiency, if the thyroid hormones are deficient, we find that the motility is reduced and it may also called constipation. So when we are learning these thyroid functions, it will be really beneficial to understand what it happens if there is excess and deficiency also, so that when we see at the applied aspects, it will be very easy for us to understand why a particular feature, clinical feature is found in that particular clinical condition. Okay, it will all be due to the underlying action of these hormones. Okay, so we have completed the action on growth and development, then action on CNS, then cardiovascular system and GIT. Moving on, the most important action of the thyroid hormone, that is the calorigenic action. So what do we mean by calorigenic action? It is an action which will increase the oxygen consumption of almost all the metabolically active tissues. How does it do that function? By increasing the sodium-potassium ATPase pump. You all know that sodium-potassium ATPase pump is a primary active transport. So it needs energy. So when this is activated, this is will cause increase in the oxygen consumption of each of the cells. So this causes, so I have given a star for this action because it is very important action. So once the calorigenic action is there, it is increasing the metabolic activity of all the cells. It will also responsible for increasing the basal metabolic rate. So what do we mean by basal metabolic rate? It is the rate of oxygen consumption and energy expenditure under resting conditions. Okay, so some amount of, even at rest, some amount of oxygen is used up and some actions are continually happening in the body which needs energy. Okay, there is a minimal energy expenditure. So this is what is called as basal metabolic rate. In presence of these thyroid hormones, the basal metabolic rate is increased. Okay, so all this increase in the basal metabolic rate, increase in the oxygen consumption, increase activity of the metabolically active tissues, all this causes increased heat production, what is called as the calorigenic action. There is, that means the body temperature will definitely go, will be higher due to the presence of thyroid hormones. If there is excess thyroid hormones, then it will cause catabolism and there may be weight loss. Okay, so overall, there is increased calorigenic action and increased basal metabolic rate due to these thyroid hormones. Next, we will, it is important to remember also that the calorigenic effect of T3 hormone is more than the T4. Obviously, we have told that T3 is more metabolic, it is more functionally capable than the T4 hormone. Its activity is more. So that's how it is. Now coming to the different metabolisms. What are the actions of the thyroid hormones on the various metabolisms? Protein, fat, carbohydrate, and also on vitamins. What is the effect? So let's begin with its effect on the protein metabolism. So protein metabolism, we need to know that normal thyroid levels are maintaining and promoting protein synthesis. Hence, they have an anabolic effect. Anabolic effect means a positive nitrogen balance where protein is formed, synthesized. Okay, it is not broken down. So there is an anabolic effect in the normal. But if there is an excess of thyroid hormone, its action becomes opposite. It has a catabolic effect and causes protein degradation. Okay. So here it is important to remember, it is not that if it is excess, the same action is happening at more. That means more anabolism is not happening. But whenever it is excess, it is becoming the opposite action. It is causing catabolism, breakdown of protein is happening. So which are the places where so much of lot of protein is stored? Mainly it is the muscle and the bone. Okay. So in the muscle, there is a negative nitrogen balance. Because the protein is lost, there is muscle weakness, what is named as thyrotoxic myopathy. Okay, when there are hormones are very, very high level, it leads to this thyrotoxic myopathy. In the bone, there is degradation of the bone protein, and hence there is decreased bone mass causing osteoporosis. So this is what happens in excess of thyroid hormones on the protein metabolism. Deficiency also, because there is no anabolism, both we can see that excess as well as deficiency, both are causing muscle weakness. Here the muscle weakness is because there is protein bulk is not there. The muscle is weak because of the absence of formation of the protein synthesis. So both deficiency as well as excess is causing muscle weakness, but the underlying mechanism is different. So that's the effect on protein metabolism, basically anabolic at normal levels. Okay. Effect on carbohydrate metabolism. So here, this is a very tricky situation for carbohydrate metabolism because it has two opposing actions. It will increase glucose as well as decrease glucose by different mechanisms. Okay, so this is all happening at normal thyroid hormone levels. Okay, it has both opposing actions at the normal levels. So first thing, it causes hypoglycemia by increasing peripheral utilization of glucose. Okay, so it's very obvious. It is causing increasing the activity in all the muscles, every cell, it is increasing. So glucose is being taken up by all these cells for the required energy. So because of the increased peripheral utilization, there is hypoglycemia. On the other hand, it causes hyperglycemia, or it increases the blood glucose level by increasing the glucose absorption from intestine and also glycogenolysis. That is, it is breaking down the glycogen that is stored in the liver and it is causing hyperglycemia. Okay, so both the mechanisms, opposite mechanisms are working. But when there is excess of thyroid hormone, it causes breakdown of carbohydrate and there is increased glucose in the blood, and this will precipitate diabetes mellitus. Okay, so it is having anti-insulin action. So there is breakdown of carbohydrate, excess of glycogenolysis will happen. And you know the insulin action. What is insulin action? Basically, it increases peripheral utilization. But here, suddenly, when it was normal level, it was pro-insulin. It was behaving something. One of its action was pro-insulin. It was increasing the peripheral utilization of glucose. But now it is, this hyperglycemic action is already there. Apart from that, this also becomes opposite. It causes anti-insulin action. Hence, it will increase the glucose level. One more way in which it does it, it down-regulates the insulin receptors. Okay, when there is excess of thyroid hormone, it not only by itself causing increasing the glucose levels, but it is not allowing the insulin. What is the job of insulin hormone? To reduce the glucose level. But it is, what it is doing, it is reducing the insulin receptors, okay, in the target organs. So down regulates the insulin receptors. So not allowing the insulin also to do its job. Thus, when the thyroid hormone is in excess, it causes hyperglycemia and diabetes-like stage. Next, coming to effect on fat metabolism. So remember that it causes lipolysis. From lipolysis, one important function of the fat metabolism is lowering the plasma cholesterol level. So it is lowering the plasma cholesterol and also to a certain extent the triglyceride level by increasing their hepatic removal. Okay, that's how they reduce. This particular action is very specific to this thyroid hormone, though it is causing breakdown of lipolysis is there, breakdown of fat, but cholesterol levels are being lowered. So when there is excess thyroid hormone, it will stimulate further, more and more fat is broken down, leading to increased free fatty acids in the plasma. Okay? So here there is no opposite effect. The same effect, lipolysis is becoming more. So you must have heard that whenever the thyroid hormone is deficient, somebody is taking the pill of thyroid hormone every day, they'll be taking. But there are so much variety of thyroid hormone actions. Even though the thyroid hormone analogs have been formed, till date, there is no thyroid analog that has formed which can mimic the cholesterol lowering effect. This is a permanent loss. If somebody's thyroid hormones are not being generated, synthesized in the body, if they are taking it externally as a tablet, this particular action cannot be done by that, cannot be replaced. Okay, some other actions only are replaced. Next, we completed all the metabolisms. Next, we will move to the vitamin metabolism. So in the vitamin metabolism, what we find is the thyroid hormone will increase enzymes. A lot of activation is there in all the cells. So a lot of enzymes and coenzymes are required. And the enzymes and coenzymes are made up of vitamins. They will use up these vitamins. So if there is excess of thyroid hormone, we find that once the vitamins are used up, there is a relative deficiency of vitamin that is happening. So this is about the vitamin metabolism. Coming to the effect of thyroid hormones on the skin. So the effect is under normal thyroid hormone level, it promotes normal hydration and secretory activity of skin. Okay, so for the normal skin to be in that particular texture, the moistness, exact thickness, all that is dependent on the normal thyroid hormone levels. Let's see what happens if there is a deficiency. Okay, so when there is a deficiency, what happens is you can see that here the diagram of the cell layers, skin layers, there is the epidermis, the dermis, the hypodermis. Okay, in the dermis, of course, more layers and all that are there. We'll not go into those details. You can see that in the dermis, there is a lot of deposition of fibroblasts, collagen, elastin, hyaluronic acid. All these are glucoproteins, which are essential for maintaining the proper structure of the skin. So all these are normally formed as well as removed for maintaining the proper levels that are required. Okay. In deficiency of the thyroid hormones, all these substances, the collagen, elastin, hyaluronic acid, are not properly metabolized. And hence, their deposition is increased. So once excess of them are deposited, they do not stay by themselves, but they are osmotic in nature. Once they become in excess, they draw more water, they draw sodium, and hence they make up a thick layer there. Okay. Hence it results in a dry, coarse, and puffy skin. So all this happens when there is a deficiency of the thyroid hormones. So in order to all these things do not happen, we need the normal levels of thyroid hormones. So what will happen if there is excess of thyroid hormones? All these are actually metabolized to a greater extent. So the thickness of this dermis will reduce, and hence the skin will become thin, and there is excess hydration, and hence there is more moist skin. So ultimately, when there is deficiency of thyroid hormones, there is dry, coarse, and puffy skin, whereas excess results in skin being thin and moist. So the normal levels will allow normal skin hydration and secretory. Next, effect on reproductive system. Effect on reproductive system is very important, very essential. Normal thyroid hormones are very essential in children for normal secondary sexual development. So normal reproductive ability. Later in adults, it is also essential for the normal reproductive ability to be there in males and females. Its deficiency results in decreased secretion, causes menorrhagia. So deficiency, menorrhagia is formed. When there is excess thyroid hormones, it causes oligomenorrhea. Oligomenorrhea means decreased menstruation, either in duration or timing, how often it happens. And it leads to infertility. That means the normal thyroid hormones are essential in all the stages, whether in utero, then in the childhood time, during puberty, and also after adult life. For the reproductive system. In all the times, the thyroid hormones have some or the other effect on the reproductive organs. So that was the list of physiological actions of the thyroid hormones. We learned about the action on growth and development, action on central nervous system, action on CVS, where it is increasing on all the parameters, action on GIT, maintaining tone, motility, calorigenic action, increasing the oxygen consumption and metabolical activity of all the cells, activating the sodium potassium ATPase pump. Then it is increasing the basal metabolic rate. Next, effect on protein metabolism, mainly it is anabolic. Effect on carbohydrate metabolism, both the actions, it can be hypoglycemic by increasing peripheral utilization and hyperglycemic by increasing gut reabsorption of glucose and glycogenolysis. Effect on fat metabolism, cholesterol lowering function, and second, it causes lipolysis, breakdown of fat. effect on vitamin metabolism, since it is activating all the functions in various cells. Vitamin being part of enzymes and coenzymes are used up. Effects on skin required for normal hydration and secretory function of the skin. Lastly, it has effects on reproductive system, starting from in utero, in childhood, in puberty, and also in the adult, male and female, very essential for the normal reproductive function. So these were the actions of the thyroid hormones, very often asked as a main question. Next, we will move on to our second objective, that is thyroid function tests. So what are these function tests? Basically, to test any particular organ, we will test whether the functions are normal. Once we find that the functions are normal, suppose thyroid gland is secreting T3, T4. So measuring T3, T4, whether it is in the normal range, would be one of the function tests. Now, thyroid gland is producing calorigenic effect. If the body temperature is normal, if the basal metabolic rate is normal, then these all indicate that the thyroid is functioning properly. So basically, function tests are tests which will test whether that particular organ is doing its job correctly or no. Now, let us make a list of the thyroid function tests which are useful to test. The first one, the radioactive iodine uptake. Let's list it, then we will learn in little bit in detail, not very much in detail. Radioactive iodine uptake by the thyroid gland. Second, serum T3 and T4 levels. Third, TSH levels, serum TSH levels. Next, protein-bound iodine. Fifth, TSH stimulation test. Sixth, TRH stimulation test. BMR, reflex time. Next, scanning of the thyroid gland will also give us some information. Lastly, biopsy of thyroid gland is a final diagnosis of what it is, how well it is functioning or over-functioning, or if there is any pathology. So these are the thyroid function tests. Nowadays, thyroid abnormality has become, unfortunately, very common, and especially in pregnancy, routinely, this thyroid function tests are ordered to know the T3, T4 levels, TSH levels, so that there is no abnormality there. So among your relatives, friends, or anybody or in the family, if anybody has got this test done, you can definitely take their reports and try to understand what is the value, how much is it, what could be the, whether it is normal or it is abnormal. If it is abnormal, in which way it is abnormal, this would definitely help you to understand little, use your knowledge here and apply there. Then you will really feel happy and understand that more better. Okay, so let's see the first one, radioactive iodine uptake. So here the iodine is tagged with, means there is a radioactive iodine, so that is injected into the body, and this iodine, as we all know, the thyroid gland will take up very effectively, because it is having a mechanism to take up iodine, tap it and use it. So we will see, then we, once we do a scan, we will look for how much of iodine was taken up. Since it is a radioactive iodine, it will come up in the scan and be visible. Okay, so the normal uptake, what is expected, is 20 to 40% of whatever the administered dose, then we will say that it is normal. But if the thyroid gland takes less than 20% of the administered dose, it is hypothyroid. And in hyperthyroid, it will take up more than 60% of the administered dose. So this is one way of finding out the functioning of the thyroid gland. We are listing out all the function tests as it evolved We had very some tests which were not very easy to perform. But as the evolution, newer techniques were coming, we are now doing only few of this. We are not doing all these tests, okay? But we are listing here all the tests. So this one test, second test which I'm telling is often done. Serum thyroid hormone concentration. So serum T4 normally, as we learned, it should be total should be 3 to 8 microgram per 100 ml, whereas the free form is 2 nanogram per deciliter. Okay, serum T3 normal level is 0.15 microgram per 100 ml and free form is 0.3 nanogram per deciliter. Reverse T3 can also be present at small amount of 2 microgram per 100 ml. Okay, so these are the values. Any increase or decrease is indicative of hypo or hyperthyroidism. Next, TSH levels. Normal value 0.2 to 5 microliter units per ml. This is very useful to differentiate between primary and secondary thyroid disease. So what we mean by primary and secondary thyroid diseases, see, if the primary means the problem lies in the particular organ. So suppose T3 is less, T4 is less, the thyroid hormones are less, hypothyroid state is there. What we mean by primary is, in spite of TRH being normal, hypothalamus is stimulating anterior pituitary, anterior pituitary is producing TSH, TSH is acting on the thyroid gland, and all the iodide, all the thyroglobulin, everything is normal, all enzymes are there, everything. In spite of that, if the thyroid gland is not producing enough T3, T4, that means the problem lies in the thyroid gland itself. Okay, that is means primary. Then we will find that TSH level will be normal, whereas in spite of normal TSH level, the T3, T4 will be less. Okay, so that is in primary. Whereas in secondary, maybe we will find that TSH level itself is less. It is not able to stimulate the thyroid gland. So T3 is less, but TSH is also less. Then it is a secondary thyroid disease. That means it is because less TSH is coming, less thyroid hormones are formed. So when we learn about the hypo, hyperthyroid and all those things, we will understand this little better. Coming to the next thyroid function, protein bound iodine. So just remember that this value will be decreased in hypothyroid, whereas it is increased in hyperthyroid, protein bound iodine. Next, TSH stimulation test. In normal thyroid, administration of TSH increases thyrotoxin and radioactive. Okay, so if TSH is given, if the thyroid is normal, definitely it will increase the T3, T4 levels. We can also do another stimulation test, that is TRH stimulation test. Here it is useful to find whether the lesion is in the pituitary or hypothalamus. So both this TSH stimulation test and TRH are used to differentiate between where the problem is. For the deficiency of thyroid hormones, whether the problem lies at the hypothalamus or at the anterior pituitary. Next, thyroid function test, scanning of the thyroid. It is used to find the hot nodules. So whenever excess activity is found in some part of the thyroid gland, it is called as a hot nodule. And usually there will be excess secretion of thyroid hormones there, and it will be a state of hyperthyroidism. So scanning of thyroid gland is one of the thyroid function tests. So hot nodule means the place where the thyroid activity is more. Biopsy of thyroid. So it helps to study the microscopic pattern and classify the type. So you take the biopsy and spread it, and histologically, if we are reading it, and we can also know whether it is normal secreting the hormone, or if there is excess secretion, or if there is some other thyroid disease pathology, we can classify all the different types. So secondly, we can also assess the thyroid function test by seeing whether the normal thyroid functions are happening. That is the basal metabolic rate, temperature, and all those things. So the 10th one, the thyroid function test, is to check for the basal metabolic rate. So normal, whatever is our normal value, plus or minus 20%, if we get, we will consider it within the normal. But if the basal metabolic rate is lower by 30 to 40%, minus 30 to 40%, it is definitely indicative of hypothyroidism. Whereas in hyperthyroidism, basal metabolic rate may be up to 100% increased. Increased by 100% more than normal. Reflex time, when we elicit reflexes, superficial and deep reflexes, in hypothyroidism, we find that it is prolonged, whereas in hyperthyroidism, it will be, the reflex time will be reduced. That is, it will be brisk. So these are the thyroid function tests. So in today's class, we have completed the physiological actions and the thyroid function tests. So the actions of thyroid hormone are quite varying. And you can see that it is literally having its effect on all the aspects like growth and development, on various metabolisms, on reproduction, and all the organs like the cardiovascular system, GIT, respiratory system, CNS. So this is a hormone which is having wide number of actions. So that was for today's class. Thank you.